thank you very much for coming. Good evening to everyone. Thank you, Eugene, for the nice introducing words. Thank you, Nikita, for inviting us, me once more. Ivan told me that I should talk quite an extensive time. He said 1.5 hours would be fine about what we are doing, especially also what we are doing at the Institute. I'm not very sure whether 1.5 hours might be too long or not. So as soon as someone falls asleep, I stop immediately. Yeah? And I'm going to show you a little bit, or to introduce you in the way we are thinking, because this is the basis of what we are doing. So undergoing any style was never our issue. Our work is very rational. It is, of course, in a certain part also very emotional, but the rationality is the basis, together with a very strict moral skeleton of what we are doing and what we are not doing. And I'm going to report about the work in total about 280, 290 people, which are in our offices in New York and in London and Stuttgart and Frankfurt and Moscow, in Dubai, in Istanbul, and I hope I didn't forget anyone, are doing so. I'm representing the success and the work of other people. I'm just a reporter. And parallel to this, I introduce you a little bit on what we are doing on our research institute, which is quite famous. I founded that institute in the year 2000. In the year 1995, I took over the Institute for Lightweight Structures, formerly headed by the famous Fry Otto, also a Pritzker Award winner, and I became his successor. And in the year 2000, the university handed me a second chair, which was a very famous one, a chair for structural engineering. It was the first chair dealing with concrete research in Germany. This fall, this chair is exactly 100 years old. And I said, okay, now I have two professorships. This does not make any sense. And the one is in the field of architecture. The other one is in the field of structural engineering. And since I'm convinced that structural engineering and architecture are the two sides of one coin, I merged the institutes to the ELEC, which is the Institute for Lightweight Structures and Conceptual Design. And we are probably the only institute in the world which teaches to the Faculty of Structural Engineering and at the same time to the Faculty of Architecture. And in many of our lectures, those students from those different groups are sitting together, do commonly design experiments and whatever. So architects learn to know engineers already in the fifth or sixth semester. They learn about their value system, the way they work, the methods and the tools they apply, and vice versa. And I consider this to be very important. And the success of the school we founded 15 years ago speaks for itself. So in the meantime, 20 professors came out of our school. And they, of course, very much influence what is going on in Germany. In order to start, I draw a wider picture, and after 4 or 5 slides, you will immediately understand why. So you will ask the question, what has this to do with architecture? A lot. So this is how people at certain times walk to work in Shanghai. And if you load down an app which is called Chinese Air Quality, it's cost free, then you might follow up what happens in Shanghai or in Beijing, and you will realize that many, many times in a year, the air is very hazardous to breathe. It's dangerous for your health to breathe. And this is nothing else than the result of urban misplanning, where the urbanists and the architects are responsible for, and a mismanagement of urban traffic. And there are still people thinking that you can separate the one from the other. But if none of both is really working and designed very well, this is the result. The second thing is this. We don't experience this here in Moscow. If you look at the Moskva, the river is relatively clean. If you go to some islands in the Pacific, if you go to islands at the African coast, you find this. And be assured that one of those plastic bottles was formerly yours. There is, in the middle of the Pacific, an area of plastic bottles swimming which is as large as Germany. You must imagine this, as large as Germany. This is the coastline of Morocco. This is unlawful sand digging. The world is running out of sand. So people, for a few pences or cents or rubles per hour, dig the sand in those cars. It's all illegal. And you can imagine what happens with the coastline if you take away the sand. You have erosion like hell. The trees will go after one or two seasons. And then the country erodes, the entire coastline erodes. The sand is used to make concrete in the Arabian countries, in the Philippines, and also Indonesia and parts of China, because the world does not have enough sand to make concrete. You may say, but Dubai and Abu Dhabi, they have plenty of sand because they're in the middle of the desert. I thought so too. But you cannot use desert sand to make concrete because the sand corns are too round by wind abrasion. They are more or less spherical, and with spherical sand corns, concrete will never gain any strength. So the people dig the sand from the Maldivian island, from the coastlines of Australia, in a depth of up to 20 meters. Of course, they dig all the fishes and what's down there and the plants at the same time and destroy the entire coastline to do nothing else than to provide sand to make concrete out of it. Per year, human beings need about 15 billion tons of sand. And of course, we all think this is a very colorful and nicely looking thing. Everyone thinks, okay, maybe I should have a ride too. It might be just a fun and an experiment and an experience. But believe that this is not an experiment and not a nice experience. It is the result of the explosion of the population, which nobody really realizes up to now. These are the indicators. In Germany, we clapped hands when in 1989 the wall was teared down. This was considered to be a big democratic progress. In the meantime, we have walls in the southeast part of Europe which were several times as long as the inner German wall. So this is how Europe, and the same is true between the United States and Mexico, and the same is true between Israel and Palestine, how the people try to separate from each other by building walls in a length of hundreds of kilometers. And I think this is not something we have to be proud of. This is something we have to be ashamed of. But if this put this all together, it has something to do with this. And this has a dramatic influence on the architecture we, and especially you as the next generation, are going to do. This is a curve we already know since 1974. The so-called explosion of population. The Club of Rome has been publishing it in a more popular sense. Of course, there were a couple of scientists publishing already before. And it indicates nothing else that nowadays, in the year 2016, the population is, what would you think? How many? Being an architect, you should know that. Okay, this is 7.4 billion, 7,400 million people. So now I'd say, okay, I don't really feel that. I don't realize that. They might be somewhere. I don't have any problem with that number. And I said, okay, maybe the number is misleading because there are 7.4 billion heads, persons in the world. But how many out of them are children? This is an interesting question. What would you think? If we define a child to be everyone younger than 16, then we have to draw a second vertical line here, the blue one, which originally more or less coincides with the yellow one. I separated them a little bit to make it better understandable. And between the blue and the yellow one, this is 16 years. And now look where the blue one hits the curve. And if you now go horizontally, you end at a number of 2 billion kids. 2 billion people not being participants of the so-called market, not being clients of any architects, they still live at home. Their mom is taking care of them. The father is paying for the food. they are not officially participating in the economy, but they will within the next 16 years. And the beds will not become empty because there's reproduction and reproduction and reproduction. But what does this mean? This means that we architects and engineers have to build a world for those kids within 16 years. And to build a world for 2 billion people in addition to the world we already have, what does this mean? So we need to go back in history and ask the question, when was the world 2 billion people big? 2 billion, we meet the curve, and it was in 1930. So the entire world, which was existing in 1930, Moscow, New York, Berlin, St. Petersburg, the Siberian Railroad, the Panama Canal, the Suez Canal, Buenos Aires, everything has to be built in addition to what is already existing within 16 years. If we would build it to the standards of 1930. In 1930, every German person had a living space of 10 square meters. Nowadays, 46. Switzerland, 56. Means if we would build the nowadays standard for those kids, we would have to build the entire world of 1930 two to three times. Nobody can imagine what that means. Nobody. You could, of course, say, those people in Africa, they don't interest me. Those people in Indonesia, in Syria, in Libya, they are not of interest for me. But, see, they all have a handheld device. And they all see how nicely you may live in Europe or in Russia or in the United States. Now, the United States have the luck that they are surrounded by water, and the only coastline where you can transit into the US is via Mexico, and there they have been building a huge wall, even shooting at people, which you might question morally too. But you cannot circumvent the problem, and this is mainly also your problem, because my generation has been totally sleeping in realizing what is coming up there. And the effect is the non-linearity in that curve. If the curve would have a constant inclination, the problem would have been foreseeable since years. But this non-linear effect is the one thing most people simply overlooked. But what does this mean? 2 billion people in 16 years is about 125 million per year entering into the market, asking for a place to live, for a place to work, and the related infrastructure. I asked the question, how much material do we need to do that? There is no scientific survey on this question. No one. Even the United Nations don't have one. So I put up a tiny research program at my institute, and we found out that every German citizen owns 490 tons of building material. Because every German owns, as a citizen, a part of the Autobahn, a part of the railroad, a part of City Hall, a part of the swimming pool, the public ones, a part of the opera, the ballet, etc., etc., plus his own living space, plus the working space. If you add that all together, it's 490 tons per person. If you now say, okay, for these kids, 125 million per year, everyone gets a German standard. That means that you have to produce building material in the amount of 60 billion tons per year, and that you have to make streets and buildings out of it. Now, what is 60 billion tons? Nobody can imagine that. No one has an idea. What would you say? I said 60 billion tons, maybe we concrete a wall along the equator, 40,000 kilometers long and 30 centimeters thick concrete wall every year. How high is the wall? Once around the world, 40,000 kilometers long, 30 centimeters thick. How high has the wall to be in order to show a dead weight of 60 billion tons? It is 2,200 meters every year. Now, if you remember the plastic waste, if you remember the sand rubbery, if you remember the fact that actually already the CO2 emissions for the production of cement are more than the CO2 emissions of the entire world air traffic. Not flying an aircraft anymore does not make any sense. The problem is somewhere else. The problem is the huge emissions caused by the building industry, now already, but multiplied with the background of this. So we draw the conclusion. We did this already since many years. We draw a very simple conclusion out of this. And the conclusion is, in its technical aspects, build for more people with less material. We cannot avoid to build for more people, but we must avoid to do that with the same amount of material with which we did it up to now, because the material is simply not there. It's a very simple rule. Write it over the entrance door of your academy. There is nothing above the entrance door. Huh? In former times, there was always a statement above the entrance door. Huh? Ars artiae, or whatever, for the beauty of the world. Now there's typically nothing. So we should write something above the entrance door. So this is the program condensed in one sentence. I give you another sentence. We do not have an energy problem. Everyone is talking about energy efficiency. This is sheer nonsense. We don't have an energy problem. The sun is shining 10,000 times more energy onto the Earth as all the human beings need, 10,000 times more. So we don't have an energy problem. The problem we have is that we use energy which is based on fossil materials like oil and coal and wood, which have been created over millions of years. It takes millions of years to make out of a forest oil. And now we are burning this within 150 years, down to the end. Instead of using it for plastic hips and plastic glasses and whatever plastic replacements or useful things made out of plastic. Now, we burn it. And while burning it, with all the emissions, we heat up the global warming. So the rule is not do not use energy. The rule is immediately stop the use of fossil-based energy. You may use solar-based energy, wind-based energy, as much as you want. You can even waste it, as long as you pay for it. This is harmless. But don't use fossil-based energy, because you are burning precious material and you are heating up the global warming. So those are the two rules, the only two rules you have to underlay your entire work. And there are, of course, architectural aspect, if I might separate it in this trivial way. And the one aspect which is underlying all our work is a saying, a sentence from the famous German philosopher Hans Bloch, which means building is always an attempt at the production of Heimat. So Heimat cannot be translated. Heimat is not homeland. Heimat is much more than homeland. Heimat is the product of the place you have been born and the trees which have been surrounding you when you were young and the smell of the area and the smell of whatever your grandma and the stories you have been hearing, all this together, this is Heimat. And this is what architects have to do. They have to create Heimat, nothing else. It is not about spectacular architectural sensation in the long term. It is about creating of Heimat. Something where the people want to live and where they feel happy. And all this, of course, has to be breathtakingly beautiful, of course. So this is four of the rules which we based as the fundamental assumptions we are working with. Now, if we want to build in a way where we use less material, it is about lightweight. Lighter buildings, extreme light buildings, and we question ourselves. I question myself, I ask myself since many decades, since I was a student, how can we, in order to be very extreme and to find the boundaries where we cannot go any step further without getting a bloody nose, how can we find the structures of least weight? What is the minimum of material we can use? And for example, one of the ways you can go has been already shown by my predecessor, Fry Otto. This is minimal surfaces given with in between certain boundary conditions. So this is a structure of minimum weight. And you, of course, realize from the very beginning on that this is obviously very complex geometries. And in order to work with them, you have to understand at least the fundamentals of differential geometry. Otherwise, you cannot talk about these things, and otherwise, you do not understand what some arbitrary selected computer program is telling you. So there should be a movie. The movie is not shown. Sorry for this. But then, once you are able to do that, you are able to bridge spans of 60, 70, 80 meters without any column in between with a structure of a thickness of 8 millimeters only. 8 millimeters spanning over 80 meters. This is like working with paper. Like you find it sometimes in nature. But don't fall into the trap. Most people are telling nature is always optimizing, and if you look at the bone is always a structural optimum. So just copy nature and you are close to the optimum. This is the sheer nonsense. Nature is not always structurally optimizing. If you have a falcon bird or something like this, which has to fly 300 meters high and then to shoot 200 meters down, it makes very much sense that the skeleton of the falcon bird is as light as possible. But don't tell me that an elephant is as light as possible. If you would be an elephant designer, the thing would much more slim and slender, wouldn't it? Okay, so what is the optimization criteria of an elephant? Obviously not material saving. And the same is true for many, many other plants and animals. So don't believe that nature is always optimizing under the aspect of saving weight. This is sometimes the case, but only sometimes. But if you do this, then you have to optimize it under the aspect of weight. I'm the only living architect who was commissioned twice by the Pope. So if we switch off the light, you see this shining ring above my head. This was the first commission. What you see here is a textile woven material with a clear span of 40 meters between the top of the columns, and the thickness is 1 millimeter. And it's high-strength material which can be folded and packed away, or which can be unfolded and stretched like the skin of a drum. And due to the pre-stress of this fabric material, it gets its stability. And due to the double curvature it shows, it gets its stability. Here you see the slightly saddle type double curved geometry of this 1 millimeter piece of fabric. We call them mechanically pre-stressed. This is a very, very effective way on how to bridge long spans. However, with a material thickness of 1 millimeter, the achievement of physical properties like sound insulation, thermal insulation, sound damping is quite difficult to be achieved. So if you optimize only in one direction, minimum weight, you might lose some other qualities. We talk about this later. If you even want to minimize what we saw with the tent for the Pope, then we come into a very interesting field. I once had a client, and he asked me to design 35 to 40 umbrellas for him. Each umbrella with a diameter of 50 meters. And I said, dear client, the world record in designing umbrellas is 28 meters or so. Now you ask me for 50. And those world record umbrellas, they stand in Saudi Arabia and they cover the interior part of a mosque. So they have to provide shade. It never rains, it never snows. And when the wind blows too harsh, they fold the umbrella away because otherwise the wind would destroy the umbrella. And now you ask me to do a 50 meter diameter umbrella which carries snow and wind loads. I cannot do that. Nobody in the world can do that. So he was very angry, he left. I was very angry because I lost the commission. I was thinking for weeks and weeks on how we could overcome this problem. And the problem with umbrellas is always the spokes. Yeah? It is not the central post which you hold. It's not the textile. If you remember your own umbrella, they always break or fail because the spokes break. So there's a famous saying by a famous Swiss engineer called Robert Maillard. And he said, if you have a structure where a certain part always breaks and you cannot explain why it breaks, just leave the part off. So I said, okay, then we need to design an umbrella without spokes. The question is how to do this. The decision was made clearly under the shower and the morning hours. The solution is an umbrella without spokes, only a central post and a huge piece of fabric. So like this. And now we make an umbrella out of it by setting it under rotation. So we work with centrifugal forces. And we replace material, which is the spokes, by energy. Now important questions arise. What if you turn like hell? Do you break through the speed of sound? And so on and so on. We did not investigate that yet. But it's very, very stable. This picture, this movie, has been taken at a wind speed at night times of 30 to 40 kilometers an hour. So the umbrella is dancing with a rotation of 1 per second, but it's very stable. Now, if it rains, you are safe below the umbrella. If you are not below the umbrella, it is easy to indicate or to calculate where the person was, because either you are wet here, or you are wet here, or wet at your shoes, because the umbrella is shooting horizontally any raindrop away. But this is working with energy part one, and it's a very interesting thought to replace material by energy. If we work still with tensioned material, now in this case air inflated, instead of pre-stressed like the skin of a drum. This is about 10 meter high plastic pipes filled up with air with a tiny LED at the footing, which students of ours had been installed in Great Britain close to Nottingham Forest. This is why they called it. Robin Hood came from Nottingham, so they called that pneumatic forest. It's interesting how much these things move under wind loading. They are, of course, not very stable. The diameter of them is 130 millimeters and the height is 10 meters. So the slenderness is radical. But moving is not a problem in itself. The same material, the same air inflated pipes, now as a twisted prism. And you see the options you have while working with these super light materials. Or this was the first building I did together with two friends. We were the responsible team for La Couverture des Arènes de Nîmes. This was a covering of an ancient Roman arena in the southern part of France. So this is where the gladiators formerly have been killing each other. This is a clear span of 90 by 60 meters. It's two pieces of fabric clamped together at an elliptic ring, which is hidden here. The steel ring is 250 meters long, 500 millimeters thick. And the material is 1 millimeter thick only. And it spans over 90 meters with a thickness of 1 millimeter. And it carries a snow load of 360 tons. And if the wind blows, the wind is tending to lift up the roof, and the lift up force of the wind is higher than the dead weight. So without any additional measures, the roof would fly away, together with the steel ring. This is real extreme lightweight structures. And of course, under this heavy wind load, about 100 kilometers an hour, the top area here moves up 1.50 meters. So the deformations of the roof is 1,500 millimeters. So it breezes, it pumps. And if you stand here, as I did, for days and weeks and months, and you monitor what you are responsible for, you see the structure breathing. But why not? 1.50 meters deformation is not a problem. Why should I limit this to 5 millimeters? Nobody interests that. So if it makes sense, you could allow for large deformations. But I show you this example in order to make clear that you can even go that far with a little material only. And while we have been working with air in an overpressurized way, this is nothing else than an air-inflated tire or cushion. This is the first structure ever built which works with negative air pressure. So we had been commissioned to develop a new grid shell technology for a company called Mero with double-curved, single-layer grid shells, and we did so. It's all about the nodal points and highly precision steelwork to bring everything together without welding on site. And then I looked at this skeleton and I said, this looks boring. This is high technology, the finest, but only engineers enjoy that. A normal, whatever, citizen which comes around the corner says, okay, what is this? So I said, we are going to throw a negligee over it. Yeah? But how to design a negligee? So we bought plastic film, very cheap one, and we sandblasted it. So the plastic film, which looked really cheap, got a surface which was very milky, like velvet, a very precious surface. And then we over-designed this plastic film in a way that we clipped it here airtight on the footing, threw it over the wall, and clipped it again against the footing. But the bag was too big. So we had all these folds and wrinkles, and then we evacuated the air out of this super bag, 30 meters long, 6 meters high. And while they pumped out the air, I was running around and I took care of the wrinkles because the arrangement of the wrinkles is the important thing in this case. And if you now look a little bit more onto the 6 meter high surface, if you look at this material, it's plastic film, 5 or 6 cents per square meter. But it is so precious. And as I always do when the building was opened, I stood away 20, 30 meters, and I looked at the people and their reaction. And it was an exhibition where typically men are present. This was not a thing. This was machine industry exhibition, so not interesting for women typically. But all these men, they saw that, and then they strictly walked. This is in reality 20 millimeters. They touched it with the hand, and they never let loose. So there were 20 men standing there doing like this. So they get in contact with the building and they fall in love with the building because of the tactile qualities. And this is very important. If your clients start touching the buildings you design, then you won. This is the victory. Because then, if they don't let loose, if they say, oh God, what is this? This is the opposite. But if they stand there and say, okay, this is something, this is my building. So as you do with your boyfriend or girlfriend, you have to do the same with your house. And then you, being the architects, you did right. So achieving what I call non-visual architecture, which is the architecture which cannot be seen. It is the architecture for the nose and for the ears and for your touching senses. You have to work very hard on the aspect of the non-visual architecture. What you are typically educated, not that much, is the visual one. Lines and surfaces, maybe colors, maybe. typically only lines and surfaces, geometries. This is typically not what the people fall in love with. Think about it. Then, when this system of vacuum facade, pieces of material held in place by under pressure, was so successful in the exhibition stand, we transferred it to a huge application. This is one of the saddest places in Germany. It's a concentration camp. It is a national monument. And due to weathering, wind and snow and whatever, rain and corrosion, this thing more or less was gone. There was plenty of protest against the government that the government had to protect this as a piece of memory. And finally, the government announced an international architectural competition to cover the leftovers with a clear span of 40 by 50 meters. So it was obvious that all those teams participating came up with structural sensations, cables and underslungs and whatever and whatever. And we said, a load-bearing structure or a piece of architecture cannot be of importance at such a sad place. People should not look at the building and admiring the architect. The opposite is true. So we did something which is super modest, and we created a building which has no visible lighting, no visible details, no bolt, just nothing. The building is only made of fabric and steel inside, which is not visible. So what did we do? We built a trivial space frame structure with walls and with a roofing, and then we mounted gratings, steel elements, on top of the bottom, everywhere, 5,000 square meters. And then we prefabricated huge pieces of fabric, airtight fabric, and we clamped it along the perimeter, threw it over the thing, brought it back inside, and clamped it again onto itself. So we created a huge bag. And then we pumped out the air. And the fabric was sucked onto the steel structure, and on the interior, the fabric laying on the ground was lifted up, and now is held via negative pressure on the ceiling. So whatever you see here in white is light transmittent, is translucent, and is held in place by negative pressure. There is no joint. Look at this. The two gray ones, this is a concrete wall. The white one is a piece of fabric. If you walk inside, if you look at the ceiling, you identify the grating. And remember, this is 2,000 square meters of ceiling held above you by negative pressure. And the energy needed to permanently evacuate the air is created by 8 square meters of photovoltaic only, because the textile is more or less airtight. So you don't have to pump that much air out of it. And then we further developed this. Again, this is now our work from the students. We said, okay, if we have the overpressurized plastic pipes and if we have the vacuum facade, why don't we combine it? And why don't we have load-bearing column-type vertical elements? And then they would, of course, fall down. So we have two plastic films, one on the back, on the front side. We evacuate the air, and the plastic films are capturing the pipes. So this is a combined action, overpressurized, underpressurized, but you do not need any drop of glue. You do not need any bolt, nothing. And this wall just stands there. The dead weight of the wall is below 100 gram per square meter. The same principle. Vertical, overpressurized plastic pipes, very thin. And then in the front of the bag, a plastic film held in place by negative pressure. So then we got keen and we said, okay, then we do the same with a shell. We build a big shell, We have elements which take the compression. These are the overpressurized pipes. And then we hold them in place and we enclose the shell by two layers of plastic films which are vacuumized and which form the final geometry. Again, dead weight in the range of 100 kilograms. It is a mono material. So there's no glue, nothing. Means if you just stop pumping the air, you can recycle that easily because it's just one materiality. There's no compound, no composite, nothing, which is of importance. And it is breathtakingly convincing, not to say beautiful. Now, if we work with structures under compression where we try to achieve minimum weight, this is not a minimum weight, but it's very, very, very low weight. It is a glass shell, which is spanning over 8.50 meters. This is all very elementary, very fundamental research work, which is the basis for all of our architectural work. But first you have to invent something before you apply it into a bigger scale. So this is metal-free. Above the equator here, there's no piece of metal. It's just double curved glass, 10 millimeter thick, 8.50 meters diameter. So if you look at the thickness to span ratio, it's 1 to 850. This is 20 times thinner than an egg, which you might have for breakfast, 20 times thinner. So it's close to work with paper. But it's still not the optimum. Why? Because this is a spherical shape. And the optimum would be something non-spherical. But then the glass would become too expensive. So we said we do it spherical. This was a grant, a sponsorship. And the next structure we did in our research, let's say history, was a non-spherical cap then. And how did we find its geometry? Very traditional. We said, OK, the geometry of a structure standing only under compression is obviously identical with the geometry of something which takes tension only in the hanging configuration. So if you take a hanging net made out of tiny chains or whatever it might be, this just hangs there. And because of the materiality, you know, this can take tension forces only. It does not move, so obviously everything is under tension. And then you flip that upwards intellectually, and you state, OK, and now everything is under compression. And then you build the structure in a bigger scale, and you state only compression. Which is not fully true, but the professors did not understand this until 1987. It's true for this shell. The famous Isler from Switzerland, one of these people which dedicated their entire life in optimizing concrete shells. Nothing else. He was the concrete shell man. We talked even in debate about concrete shells. Imagine this is a 40 meter clear span between the three supports of each of those two shells. And even Heinz Isler, the best of the best at his time, needed average 25 centimeters of concrete thickness. So 25 centimeters of thickness of the shell means the dead weight of the shell is 600 kilograms per square meter. The wind is 100, the snow is 100, 150. So dead weight is the governing number. Dead weight is higher than everything else together. So it makes very much sense to design a structure for dead weight. Because if other loads occur, which you have to superimpose to the deadweight load, they are relatively small. So their effect is small. But now, over the years, when the materiality quality, the material qualities were increasing, when the ways you could calculate structures were getting better and better and better, when the safety concepts got better and better and better, you could decrease that. And nowadays, I would say, we would be able to build that with 3 or 4 centimeters, not 25, 3 or 4 in concrete. But the dead weight then would be 10 kilograms per square meter, not 600. But this would mean, sorry, 100, not 600. But this would mean that the wind and the snow load would be much higher than the deadweight. And the question would be then, yeah, why should we do the form, the shape governing loading case, taking the deadweight and not the snow? But you never know where the snow lies and where the snow melts. So you have no shape defining, form defining loading case anymore, which I called the tragedy of the modern lightweight engineering. You lost the fundamental assumption, which is the load, the form defining loading case, which was deadweight all the time, typically. But what then if you build something like this, another of our experiments where we draw our know-how from? This is over the diagonal, 14 meters, made of wood, and is 40 millimeters thick. So the dead weight is 24 kilograms per square meter. The wind is more than 100 and the snow is around 100. So dead weight is just a quantité negligible. But what to do? What to do? And again, we remember the umbrellas and we said, okay, we do not know whether the shape looks like this if we have a snow load here, or it should like this if we have typically a snow load here, because we don't know how the snow load comes and how it is distributed. So we said, we design it under another aspect, and we make it that thin that it just stands for dead weight. And if we have a non-symmetrical loading, it collapses. Whatever the load is, it will collapse, definitely. Now we worked like hell, and the shell is very precious. There are thousands of students' hours of work in it, so it's about 500,000 if you would buy it. So we don't let it collapse. So what we do is, forget about this, this is not architecture, this is research. We have about 14 points in the shell where we, via sensors, measure the deformations. And then we interpolate and extrapolate in between those 14 points. And then we know all the deformations over the entire shell. Knowing the deformations allows us to know about the stresses. If we know about the stress, then we know where is an overloading, where is an underloading, where will it break. If we know this, then, chapter two, we artificially move millimeters only three of the four abutments, there where the hydraulic units are, millimeters only, in real time. And if the shell collapses this way, then we move these supports in a way that would collapse this way, and the sum of this plus this is zero. So by pumping energy into it via a footing point deformations, we counterbalance any collapse movement of the shell. So this is again building with energy. Or for the few engineers amongst you, this is a non-uniform snow loading, which creates at the anchor points huge stresses, which cannot be taken by a wooden shell. It would definitely break. And then by moving the support points, we smoothen the stress configuration. We homogenize the stress fields within a part of a second. So nothing happens. And then, okay, people say, okay, but you need more energy than you save with the material. This is not true. The point in time when the energy we need to balance the shell is exactly the energy we saved at the very beginning is after 40 years. Now, what does this mean for practice? We won a competition as architects and engineers for a high-speed elevator testing tower. So the tower you see is 245 meters high. It's a concrete pipe within which we have 10 shafts for high-speed elevators, which run about 60 to 70 kilometers an hour. This is elevators which do not need any longer cables and counterweights and so on. They run like a magnet train. Means they can change speed easily. They can even go vertically, sidewards, and vertically due to the magnetic train technique. And to test this, whether it really works and what the implications are, The company ThyssenKrupp, who invented it and which holds the patent, needed a test shaft of nearly 300 meter length. So the tower goes 45 meters into the ground and 245 meter above ground. A concrete pipe does not look that interesting. So we said, again, what is also beyond the aesthetic, a critical aspect with those concrete pipes? The one thing is, if this is a cylindrical pipe, it tends to vibrate heavily under homogeneous wind loading. If the wind speed at a certain speed is homogeneous and not turbulent, then the thing that might even fall down. So this effect is already known since 1850, 1880, and a British engineer named Scruton, he came up with the idea to put something on the chimney to make the cylinder very irregular in order to create artificial turbulences which avoid that effect. So we mounted steel pipes around the concrete shaft, and in between the steel pipes, we pre-stress fabric. So this, on the one hand side, hides the concrete. On the other side, avoids these vibrations, uncontrolled vibrations. And the third thing is the fabric provides shadow to the concrete, which is very important because those concrete pipes, which you use for tower, have one big problem. And this is not earthquake. This is the sun shining in the early afternoon on one side. In the interior, they are cold. In the northeast side, they are cold. And in the southwest side, they get very, very warm due to the sun shining. So the cylindrical shafts tend to overlie due to thermal expansion. And this is very critical. But if you have a shading element on top of the concrete, you don't have thermal overloading. So this is what we combined here. And now, for the first time ever in history, these elevator engineers, there are 60, 70 engineers sitting in this tower doing experiments with the elevators. They want to test it under zero wind load. But what should you do if the wind is blowing in that city of Rottweil and the tower is moving? Then 70 people may go home for 3 days. So we installed the technology in a height of about 180 meters here, inside where we artificially move a 200 block ton of steel in a way that it counterbalances the natural vibrations and the tower stands still, zero deformations. The other cases, so this is the easy part of it. Huh? It's not easy, but the other thing is the engineers there said, but we also want to test our elevators under earthquake and strong wind conditions. But there is never any earthquake there. And strong winds maybe 2 days a year. So they could not test the elevators. And then we said, using the equipment we already have, doing some slight modifications, we set the tower under deformations artificially. So we went to the building department, to the building administration, said, OK, we apply for a permit. This is a tower which might move automatically. Then the man got white-faced, and they said, but there is no self-destroyment. It is, of course, possible that the tower destroys itself, but based on our technology, it will never happen. Then the man was more or less transparent. He was under shock. He said, I will never sign this. It took a lot of talks and convincing the administration in order to get an allowance for this. But now this is the first tower which is artificially set into spectacular vibrations. If we want to do lightweight engineering, lightweight architecture in a less spectacular way, what we are typically doing is that we form the shape of the building members or the structures in a way that they, for example, follow the line of moments. Even Ivan Tomovich probably already told you what a line of moment is. The outcome is such a wonderful design, unfortunately never built in the late 50s of the last century. But what does this mean, forming a girder along the line of moments. Of course, on the very top, this is a bridge. It must be a plane. But below, you are allowed to do some undulations. To do what? To guarantee that the maximum stress in the material is always the same, is a constant on the top as well as on the bottom. So if you have one and only one material along the bridge, the maximum stress in the material always occurs here along this line. This makes sense. So this is the maximum tension, and there's the maximum compression. And in between, as you already learned, the stress is decreasing down to zero, increasing to the other maximum. Means there's too much material here. If there are areas where the stresses are lower than the maximum stress the material can take, there's too much material. What does this mean? We always remember the wall we have to build every year, 40,000 kilometers long, 2,002 meter high. Every centimeter we save is a big fortune. If we look, for example, into nature, now in this case, it's allowed to look into nature. The shaft of a piece of grass or wheat or whatever it might be, it's a tubular structure, cylindrical, hollow inside, small pores and bigger pores. The pore's density and its distribution, very, very logic. Only designed following two aspects. The one is liquid transport vertically, and the other one is stiffness or strength. So we asked ourselves, if we would be able to build concrete bridges, beams, concrete element, which are porous inside and super dense outside where the maximum stress occurs, so that all elements here, even every atom, is undergoing the same loading under certain wind, then this would be the minimum of material which can be used. But how to do this? Now, everyone said this will never work, give it up. I started then 15, 17 years ago not to give up. Got a patent for it, but did not really know how I would do it. Now, in the meantime, we are able to do that. We did plenty of research in the foam technology and the science of how foams work, soap film foams, for example. You see the black lines, which are called plateau edges, after the Belgian mathematician Plateau, who first invented the functionality of those lines. We went into the technology of sponges, where we do not have the diaphragms in between those plateau edges. We built those sponges in another size, in another scale. The openings here are 800 millimeters. Why did we do so? Because we needed to understand, to comprehend, what is the geometry of these tiny surfaces here? In reality, they are submillimeter, but you cannot understand it if you look with a microscope into that submillimeter range. If you look in a wider range, in another scale onto it, then you understand that they are partially double curved and single curved and how that works. So once we understood that, we went back and started doing bigger models and developing the technology. And developing that technology, it came into our mind what we already know since 100 years, that the arrangement of cavities might be such or such. A spherical cavity is not a good thing by its own. This is a human bone. Femur, connecting the hip to the knee. Now what happens here? This is a vertical load, half of my dead weight goes through the hip to the knee. So the bone is an element under compression. What is the ideal cross-section for such an element because of buckling? It's a hollow pipe where all the material is here at the perimeter of the pipe, hollow inside. But stupid as nature is, or maybe there's a reason we do not fully understand, we just can think it might be the case, the structural support is here, not there. If this would be the contact to your hip, then the load, the force would go vertically down into the pipe. But the contact point is here. So you create an eccentricity. The least thing you can do when you are a lightweight engineer is create eccentricity. This is just forbidden. Rule number one, never any eccentricity. And nature is doing it. See, and if you, when you walk, you carry your bones and you lift them back and forwards, this takes energy. And now nature, without any, let's say, tough reason, is increasing the dead weight of that bone. Okay, the eccentricity allows you for better movement out of plane. This is the real reason. But how to deal then with this catastrophe? Catastrophe under a lightweight person's aspects. Look at the infill of the bone. The thick exterior wall disappears to nothing. The hollow area inside is filled up with some spongy material. And if you look close at it, there's a certain regular behind it. There's a certain logic. And there was a Scottish researcher named Darcy Thompson who found out that this is the patterning. The diaphragms are following the separating walls between the cells. It's very, very logic. It's always a right angle, 90 degrees where they meet. And the layout is the so-called trajectory layout. And if you put the material along the trajectories, then you are somewhere close to the minimum of material needed. Okay, but how to build a piece of concrete following that rules? In the meantime, we are capable to do that. What you see here is different samples. Look at this density, which is very high here, and then we have porous, tiny cavities here, and they become density again. Here we have a homogeneous porosity. The same is true here. Just forget about this now and the next time. How do we do that? How are we able to build concrete elements where the density of the concrete is varying in the three axes in the space, homogeneously? We do this using a robot, which has two nozzles. The one nozzle is a very dense, high-strength concrete, and the other nozzle is a super foamy, super lightweight concrete. And we spray the concrete with both nozzles at the same time into the formwork. And sometimes we have more of this and less of this, or zero of that and 100% of this. And depending on the mixture of the two streams of concrete, we may vary the dead weight between 300 and 2,500 kilograms per cubic meter. So we vary the density. We have plenty of tiny cavities, but only tiny ones, because using foaming concrete, the diameter of the cavities is somehow limited to 2 millimeters. Where we already saved 50-60% of material. With a load, same load-bearing capacity, the concrete needed was only 40% of a traditional solution. And you see here in that concrete beam on the right-hand side, this is just an explanation of the flow of forces, compression, and the red here is a very high tension force. And you see where we have densities and less densities and how we do that. This was one of the first experiments. In the meantime, we have hundreds of them and far more refined. And then we had the idea to have bigger cavities, not 2 millimeter, but 250. Also mono material. Then we invented concrete spheres, hollow spheres, which are laid by robots into the spraying thing. And you realize that there are passes where we have no bubbles and there are other regions where we have the bubbles. So then we fell into the theory of maximum package density, which is a super complex mathematical theory. But if you ask yourself the question, okay, which hollow spheres do we have to arrange in which way in order to have the forces still transferred, but achieving the minimum of material, then you have to consider whether you have a concrete beam where you have bubbles of one diameter, one after the other, where you have four in the section and a package of four, one after the other, or a package of 16, one after the other. The interesting result is the weight of the concrete beam is always the same, independent whether you have one or four or 16. The weight is always the same. You save 52%. But now we said, okay, if we have bubbles of one diameter, there is still some volume in between them. This is the red bubbles. If we come up with another layer of red bubbles, then we are able to save up to 70%. And then inside those concrete structures, it looks like this. And now you remember the photograph I showed you with the white foams, the sponges, where we did the first materials. I think it looks so beautiful that everyone would love to live in such a piece of concrete. So this is a very regular section which we investigate and research with our scientific people. This is a structural nodal point inside a concrete beam. Using that technique, we might even pour concrete shells, double curved, where we have openings in the shells, depending on the stresses within the elements. On the left-hand side, you see the stress fields, and on the right-hand side, you see the piece of shell, which in its geometry, one-to-one represents the stress fields. So this is absolute super lightweight. Yeah, still tired? Or not that much tired. Now we have to translate that permanently into what we are building. This is always a back and forth and back and forth. So this is the Mercedes-Benz Museum, the up to now most complicated concrete structure ever built, ever. The designers was Ben van Berkel, UN Studio. We did the engineering. There is more or less no right angle in that building except the doors to the elevators. Everything is double curved, exposed concrete with clear spans up to 40 meters with dead weights of those people, of those pieces of more than 1,000 tons. So it's not really lightweight engineering. But what we learned there is double curved surfaces in exposed concrete, which is not that easy. Very irregular surfaces. So see, this is the formwork. And if you ask someone, how do we do a formwork which is double curved of highly precision? Then you have to come back to cutting pattern technology, which you use in the clothing industry here, for my jacket, for example. If you want to get this fabric around the shoulder, the fabric is a plain element. You can roll it and unroll it, but you never get it around a double curved thing. So there is a reason why this seam is here and not here. Yeah? The same is true for your trousers. So trousers which fit best the body have a certain patterning. If the patterning is wrong, the girl does not, or man does not look good. So it is, all the technology is in the cutting pattern. For the jacket, for the trousers, and for the concrete elements. So the cutting pattern we applied here meant that we had thousands of those dark brown elements cut with a hydrojet with a precision of less than 1 millimeter. They've been brought to the side and just fitted one to the other without any joint or gap. And then we poured the concrete. So this is in 2003 where we developed the method, and now we have the know-how to do double curved exposed concrete, which looks perfect. We just go one back. Look how perfect it looks. And from then on, we further developed all what I mentioned. See, this is an atrium of an office building, and there is a roof above the atrium, and the extension of the roof is about 40 by 40 meters, and it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in the 8th floor. So the question is, how do we do the roof? It should be flooded with light, It should be not too expensive. It was obvious that we do lightweight engineering. The question is, what is the optimum between the number of columns and the steel needed for the roof? If you have four columns only, the roof is of course thicker because the spans are bigger. If you have 20 columns, the spans in the roof are smaller, so you need less steel for the roof, but more steel for the columns. So it turned out that four columns is the optimum. But what are you doing then if you have a clear span of 25 to 28 meters here? This is a human being, between the columns with the roof. Okay, we said the roof is glazed, every glass pane has the same size, every joint has the same size, so the roof is totally regular, orthogonal grid, in order to keep the cost down. But then the only variable we had, or which we allowed ourselves, is the height of the structural beams of the grid. And you already realize that the height is not constant. We look from below, above, and you see wherever we have the columns, the height is increasing. And at mid-span between the columns, the height is only 100 millimeters. Very, very slender. Now, if you look at it from the side, it becomes very logic. And it's quite obvious that any element of decoration, any bolt or whatever it is, would destroy this appearance. It must be very, very strict and simple, because the elegance comes from the simplicity. So these squares are about 1.50 meters by 1.50 meters. And it's just hollow box steel beams painted white. So very often, if you minimize a structure to the absolute end, then there's something evolving which I call eigenbeauty, which is the beauty which comes out of itself, comes out of the logic. A little bit the same case is here. We won an architectural competition, which is a bus station for 10 or 15 buses. And look at these tiny, slender columns, and they are only 120 millimeters thick. So they're like needles. The problem with those roofs is always the downpipe for the rainwater, because this is that fat. Structurally, you need this. For the rainwater, you need this. So I said I want to have only two downpipes, and the rest of the roof has to be more or less flat with very thin needle-type columns. So how do we do that? If you have such a huge roof, you have to incline the roof in order to guarantee the water flow to the downpipe. This all looks ugly, forget it. And since there's a river directly behind, we took up the idea of waves of the river. And then we designed the roof in such a way that every raindrop which falls on the roof is due to the inclination here brought to two points only. So the surface of the roof is the result of a rainwater engineering, where we said we have two points where the water may flow down, and all the other surface where we collect the water has to be inclined in a way that the water is flowing to those two points. So the roof is above. See, and this then allows that the columns become very, very thin at the very top. This is another example of what we do. This is the tallest carbon fiber structure ever. It's close to 60 meters high, carbon fiber pipes. It's an artwork from a New York artist, and it stands in Munich. Or this is the, I'm not out for records, this does not interest me. This is titanium pipes. The facade building has been designed by Hans Hollein, friend of mine who died much too early, is titanium pipes with a length of up to 14 meters here. The thick lines is where we have two of those titanium pipes together. And here you nearly don't see them. They're only 50 millimeter in diameter. And the wall thickness is 0.5 millimeters. So imagine you have a pipe which is spanning from the upper edge to this balcony over a length of 14 meters, and the diameter of it is 50 millimeters with a wall thickness of 0.5. This is like building with paper. We needed the minimum of titanium. And the titanium solution was as expensive as the stainless steel. But the stainless steel would have had much thicker wall thicknesses, higher dead weight, sag due to dead weight, and all those problems. So sometimes it is better to buy a very expensive material, but to use less of that material. At the end, the cost is the same. Okay, this is the art piece in carbon fiber seen from below. This is something, the last building of Jan Kaplitsky from Future System. This is a memorial museum for Enzo Ferrari, the Italian car maker. So it follows the car body of a Ferrari. It's made of aluminum painted in Ferrari yellow. It is seamless and jointless. It's one piece, brought together to one piece. This is with Zaha Hadid, one of the buildings we did with her. This is in Azerbaijan. This is another building. The connecting point between the two shells, which represent the shape of sails in the Chinese sea, this point here is in a height of 60 meters. So you get an idea of the dimension of that. Seen from inside, there's cable nets forming the load-bearing element for the double curved facade. And the things which are cladded in white, this is a steel pipe grid shell. This is a facade, not the main structure, this has nothing to do with lightweight, but the facade as the contradiction of the top of the roof and its supports has been designed by us as a more or less immaterial glass facade. It's about 18 meters high and 200 meters long, all made of glass. This is interesting too here because this facade here is 8 stories high, square sized in elevation, and the only lines you see is the silicone joints between the glass because the load bearing elements are so thin that they are thinner than the silicone joints. The load bearing elements is steel cables spanning from the top to the bottom with a diameter of 20 millimeters only over 8 stories. So this is the load bearing element in a spacing of 2 meters. If you ask a regular facade engineer, okay, how thick is the mullion? He typically would say, okay, if we work with 8 floors, it is about 1 to 20. So 8 floors is 32 meters roughly, and 1 to 20, that means that the mullion is that deep. In our case, the mullion is that deep. What is the difference? The difference is that structurally it is stable, but it undergoes huge deformations. If the wind blows heavily onto that facade, which happens one time in 50 years, then the facade deflects inward by up to 400 millimeters. Why not? 400 millimeters sounds unacceptably much, difficult, causing problems. It is not. Remember this white air inflated cushion in Nîmes. It deforms 1.50 meters. Why not? The only problem might occur if those deformations are such that in the corner points area here, the glass panes undergo a torquing or a warping. You just have to guarantee that this does not happen, and then large deformations of such a glass wall are not a problem at all. Now, coming to an end, we could not touch all the aspects which are important. I gave you the 4 general rules, but these are only 4 out of many. Build more, build for more people with less material, stop the use of fossil-based energy, do everything to create Heimat, and design the things you are doing breathtakingly beautiful, because if the people don't fall in love with your architecture, they will never protect it. But this aspect of using as little as material as possible also means that you have to introduce recyclability into architecture. Definitely, there is no way around this. And why not? It means build the buildings in a way that you compose them on day one and that you decompose them on day two or after 1,000 years or whenever, but that they have the ability to be decomposed. And breaking the thing into its part should allow you then to identify the elements and to recycle them in a perfect way. Nowadays, we call that cradle to cradle. This is the path to follow. So see, this is the house I'm living in. This is the first 100% recyclable, zero energy building of modern times. I'm living in since 16 years, so for me it's already boring. It's a four-story house with one room, one four-story room. So you can look from the top floor to the bottom floor internally. And to prevent any rumor, there are two toilets and there's a wall wrapped around the toilet. But everything else is open. So you lie, you wake up in your bed, and then you can look 360 degrees around you and you see the birds cruising around the building. And in winter times, the house is frozen from outside, so there's ice on the facade because the insulation of the glass is so super that the warm water from warm air from the city condenses outside and then freezes. So sometimes it takes up to 11 or 12 o'clock in the morning in winter times until the ice melts and then you can look out of the house again. But it's 100% decomposable. But that means that there's no electric wiring somewhere embedded in a concrete, in a plastered wall, because this is against recyclability. So all the wires, all the pipes, everything is in open channels with a flap to close it. There is no switch anymore. This house is completely free of any switch. So if you use the toilet, you raise your hand, and then the toilet flushes. It's like Spaceship Enterprise or so. Super. For me, it's boring. So this house, built in the year 2000, has over the year an energy consumption of zero over the year in the balance. I mean, sometimes we have a dramatic overproduction. Sometimes we have an underproduction. Then we have to pull the electricity out of the net. Okay, this is technology of 2000. Then we won a competition for the German government. The Chancellor Merkel was the opening person here. This house produces 170% in the year's balance of what it needs. It has no chimney, no emission. This house has no emissions either, no chimney. There's no fireplace, nothing. It's all clean. It does not contribute to global warming. This house, again, is 100% recyclable. It is a demonstration pavilion in the center of Berlin, so you might access it here until this glass wall. There are sunken TV screens which explain you the technology so that you can learn something. The house talks to its car, and the overproduction in energy is then fed into the car. So this is our technology in the year 2012. Now, this is our technology in the year 2014. A house which stands in Stuttgart, it's very tiny because of restrictions for the building laws. This is 200% energy production. You can cut the house from the grid in the summertime for 3 days. It does not need any contact to any power plant. It has electric batteries, it has an ice tank, it has a hot water tank. So the house is totally independent. And as I said, 200%. And the house talks to its electric cars, to its electric bicycle via radio contact. And it talks to an already existing house designed by Le Corbusier in 1927, which is this one. This is a national German monument, so you cannot touch it. It has to remain in the way it is. But of course, energetic-wise, it is a catastrophe. It needs energy like hell, in summer as well as in winter. So what we do is, this house has one of our electronic systems which evaluate the need of energy over the next hours and days. And the system clearly knows that tomorrow morning between 8 and 9, we need that many kilowatt hours. In order doing so, it communicates with our super flat overproducing house, and this house then knows, okay, the car needs this one. I myself need this one. This needs this one. Is there still an overflow or not? How do I manage the energy streams? So we call that the principle of sisterhood, that the strong sister, the young one, the overproducing one, feeds the weak one, the elder one. By the way, the interesting thing is looking at this picture compared to nowadays, is that the dress code of the lady is quite advanced. The design of the car is very antique, and the design of the house is very advanced too. Nowadays, in many cases, if you look at the cars and if you look at the buildings, it's vice versa. So coming back to our house, you might even drive with your electric car into the living room because it has no emission, no exhaust pipe. This is an electric smart. And if you fear to drive out backwards because everything is glazed, there's a turntable which rotates the car, so you drive forward inside, forward outside. The house has been installed in one day. It was a complete ready-made. It has the most advanced glazing units ever seen. This is vacuum glazing with a U value of 0.3. The terrace here can be flipped upwards, so the house is totally closed in case you want to sleep or you are on vacations or so. So nobody may enter because there's no door anymore. Everything is away. It's just a white box, the facade of which is fabric, textile. Again, this is glass fiber textile. Easy to separate it, easy to recycle it. It protects the wooden box behind so that you do not need any painting or whatever on the wood. The wood remains wood. When the building is going to be decomposed, you take away the facade, you have the wooden box, you may put that on the compost or whatever. See, this is the corner. On the right-hand side, you see the fabric forming the facade, and there's a thin aluminum profile, which is the edge. There is no such precision on other buildings. So instead of having flat fabrics, we of course research what happens if we fold the fabrics, if we work with our under pressure technology, etc., etc. So this is the world we are living in. We implement operable units, in this case 100 millimeter diameter, which allow for breathability of the facade. In a more archaic technology, but not that bad, or in a more advanced technology, using air-inflated fibers in order to make a facade breathable. Not open the window, the entire facade breathes. And so on, and so on, and so on. So, stop at this point. And I think a resume is not necessary because it was quite obvious. If you need to build for more people with less material, if you want to avoid strictly the use of any fossil-based energy, if you follow the objective every architect has to follow, which is the creation of Heimat and beauty, and you take this as the four basic rules, it is not always that simple and easy to achieve that objective, definitely not. It is very, very hard work of many people over many years. But maybe I opened a couple of doors for you. Maybe I gave you some ideas and some guidelines on how to proceed. So I wish you all the best and have a nice evening. Everyone is hungry and thirsty.
I have a question concerning is there less room for error when you, let's say, reduce the weight of the for example, the beam when you were showing the reduction of the material that
yeah.
was used to build to construct the beam.
Yeah.
But what if the error happens? Like, there is less room for error in this case. The technology must be very advanced to achieve the perfect result, right?
You cannot do that with common workers. It's all done by robots.
So therefore, the countries that are less developed, they have more bigger population, and vice versa, let's say, the Germany, which is...
Yeah. This is a very interesting and also, in a hidden way, critical question. My answer is very simple. See, there are thousands of students and young researchers from the United States, from Germany, maybe from all other countries too, doing seminars on low-cost housing for the so-called third world. I never talk about third world because I think this is an unfair term to, let's say, separate the world into a first, a second, and a third one. This is a piece of arrogance. Let's call it the problem on how to build for poor people, which do not have a certain technology. And what is the outcome of all those seminars which are funded by the United Nations? I'm old enough to predict that. The outcome of any of those is a guideline of the people there, of the local people, and how to take mud and waste and empty Coca-Cola bottles and so on to shelters or more rectangular thing depending from which university the students are coming from. Hmm? Help to help the people. Help yourself. No one, simply no one, is talking about the wiring and the plumbing of the toilet, of the kitchen, of the wash basins, and all of those sticky things architects typically don't talk about. But exactly this one is where Ebola and typhus and malaria and all this stuff is born. But if you want to help those people, and no one, even nor you, nor me, nor you, are able to do, let's say, the piping and draining system of a house in a way that it really works. This needs a certain technological education and background, a craftsmanship. How can you come up with the idea to ask someone from Central Africa to design a toilet which really works and where you can clean the wastewater? They can't do that. So the problem is not to tell them how to make a clay shell with the infill of Coca-Cola bottles. The problem is to tell them how to do the sewage thing or to give them a unit, which is called, this is a fridge, to give them a unit which is prefabricated and pre-tested, which is called, this is an energy management system. There's two PV cells and there's one battery and you just need to plug in your hair blower and then it works, and to give them a unit which means dirty water in, clean water out. This is what you have to deliver from a technologically highly developed country, definitely. Now, if it comes to those materials, sometimes, okay, doing a wall in mud and clay, this is not the big problem. But if you have a school, if you have a kindergarten and you want to do a ceiling or a roofing over it, where there is no wood available, like in most parts of Africa, it makes sense to do it with concrete. And I do not have a problem to say, okay, there's an easy and trivial robot and the robot is going to spray that concrete slab. Not a problem for me. Of course, the people there are not longer doing concreting slabs. But I think there are better things to do. Yeah, you can farm your vegetables, you can take care of other people which are ill or old and so on and so on. This is not the most delicate thing to do, pouring concrete slabs. It's also not a technologically advanced thing. And if you, by the way, save 50% of material then, which you do not have to bring from the big harbor cities like Lagos over several hundred kilometers into the depths of the country, this is always the better solution. It is totally okay to bring a certain level of technology to those people in the poor world, definitely. if you really help them with that technology, like the water cleaning box. This is something they really need. There is no water cleaning box available in this world. The people are suffering from waste, dirty water, and there is no unit there. And you can produce such a unit for a few hundred dollars only, maybe 150 if you sell plenty enough of them. And 150 is nothing. If you shoot down one of the military jets, for the cost of the military jet, you can feed an entire population with water cleaning units. My intention is to redirect your thinking and to come down to the real roots of the problem. The real root is not whether a Gucci or whatever piece is too expensive or whether you can get it more cheap there or if your Ferrari is going faster than a Lamborghini. This may make fun and this is totally okay, but the problems which are coming up and which will be your problems have another dimension. And I'm not a pessimist, not at all. I do not want to make you sleepless, definitely not. But if you do not accept those problems, if you do not understand them, then you are not able to manipulate them. And if you are not going to manipulate the upcoming problems, then you are all lost, definitely. Because of war, because of migration, because of hundreds of millions of people which are just looking for food. How do you want to deal with that? There are still kids at home. But if you take countries like Nigeria in Central Africa, Nigeria was 85 million at the turn of the millennium, 85 million people. Nowadays there are 190 million, and in 2025, which is in 9 years, they are predicted to be 300 million people. How do you want to manage this? Even the most clever government and administration is unable to manage such a growth. So they look at their handheld and they come to Russia and to Germany and wherever there is a corner to sneak in. Definitely, we would do the same. We did the same. Our grandparents, they did the same. There's all this romanticism. Go to the United States, go to South Russia, you will find Germans which still speak German since 300 years. Yes, they are there. And why are they there? They fled Germany because of poverty and hunger.
Yeah. Herr Ersten, ich möchte sagen, vielen Dank fürs Interesse. Und jetzt meine Frage. My question is about this prison facade. I'm very concerned about how the work contained a special quantity of air or light to make it open up and close in.
This prison facade?
Yeah.
Okay, the one, this one.
Yeah.
The slot, we call that the slot type. You need air, pressurized air. But the energy you need to pressurize the air is not that much. The trick is very simple. It's too simple, I shouldn't tell you. Okay. You take a hollow pipe of plastic, and in this case, you glue on the one half of it a piece of super thin metal film. Might it be a chicken grill aluminum film or whatever. Yeah? Then if you inflate it, where you have the metal film, it cannot elongate, but on the other side it elongates. So the sausage gets a curvature. There is the metal, there's no metal. Huh? So we took two of them, we wove them into the fabric, and then you just have to pump a little bit and the slot opens and closes.
It was working automatically.
It is like this. You can do it with a bicycle wheel air pump. So the energy consumption, I would say, of 100 square meter of facade is done by two or three photovoltaic cells,
so
maximum.
Air,
yeah, it's only air pressure. You pump it in, you pump it out. The thing bends, gets straight, bends straight as you pump. It's quite simple.
The last question. I'm this optimistic.
They are all much younger.